So good. South Carolina. Isn't that cool? Actually, our good friends at Southern Wesleyan University made this little replica, and they let us borrow this. Now, they say this is Martin Luther's good side. I don't know what his bad side looked like. Not sure he had a good or a bad side. Grayson, I'm going to throw Grayson under the bus, was commenting on his multiple chins. But I said, Grayson, that was a sign of blessing in that time because everybody was sick and dying, so he was very blessed, you know. But at any rate, leaving all that aside before I get myself in some major trouble here, Martin Luther was an Augustinian monk in the Roman Catholic Church. Now, what does that mean? That basically meant that pretty much all day long, Martin Luther read Scripture, meditated upon Scripture, prayed, and would spend time teaching the Scripture in Latin to students. That's what the man did day in and day out. And you're saying, well, why is he so important? And why whatever he did there on that door, why is all that so important? And why are we still talking about it? And why are we still celebrating it 500 years later to the extent that we would take 3 Sunday mornings and preach about what happened 500 years ago? Well, I hope by the end of this sermon today, you will understand just how important and groundbreaking this was for us. You see, during the time of Martin Luther, there were many pockets of the church that had begun to be restless, that had begun to question the authority of the papacy, that's the Pope and the Roman Catholic Church. They thought that there were some abuses going on. People like Peter Waldo, people like John Wycliffe, people like Jan Hus. All of these were men who said, we need to return to the Bible. The church has gotten so far away from primitive Christianity. Is that a term you're aware of? It's gotten so far away from the basic essential elements of what made the church in the New Testament. And we need to return to that. So by no means was Martin Luther the first guy that came along and decided that there were some reforms that needed to be made. But he may have been one of the most bold of these guys that stepped forward and did what he did. You see, during his time, there was something going on that he could not jive with. The Roman Catholic Church was beginning to do something called selling indulgences. And essentially what that meant was, now you come in here this morning, and if you've got something that's not right in your heart with God, what do you do? Do you pay God to get your heart right? Or do you come before the Lord broken and plead Jesus Christ as your only advocate before the Father? Well, what was happening at this time is they were saying, if you want forgiveness of sins, you've got to buy it. We've got to actually write you a letter of indulgence, a receipt that says you paid not only to have your sins forgiven, but one of your loved one's souls could get out of purgatory if you would pay these things. Now this to you sounds ridiculous. I know that. I remember reading this when I was a little kid and saying, that is the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. But you're taking some things for granted when you say that that's ridiculous. Number one, what was going on at this time in Europe? Well, for centuries there was a plague going on that was known as the Black Death. And the Black Death meant that if you had a child, there was only about a 25% chance that they would survive to being 5 years old. The Black Death was a cruel sickness that was taking over Europe. And the church at this time was the most powerful institution in the world. And the church at this time was telling people that this life is an awful, miserable life. But you can have the hope of heaven if you'll do everything we say, and if you'll pay these indulgences, you can have a hope beyond this life. Now, understand, friends, that that was music to their ears of people who were dying by the millions. They wanted to see their loved ones again. They wanted to escape the miserable life they were in, so it seemed like a fair deal to them. So Martin Luther, at first, didn't set out to overthrow the whole Catholic Church. He didn't set out to overthrow the Pope. He just wanted to come out against this awful, evil practice known as the selling of indulgences. And that's when he went to the Wittenberg Castle Church door and nailed his 95 theses there, where he argued against the selling of indulgences for the forgiveness of sins. Now you can imagine this had become a very lucrative practice for the church. In fact, it was the way they were funding the renovations of St. Peter's Basilica. And they had a man in Germany at the time by the name of John Tetzel who was taking up all this money. And he got upset with Martin Luther because he said, now people aren't as likely to buy these indulgences anymore. And so the hierarchy got upset with Martin Luther. And they said, you know what? You are going to answer for your crimes. And so they sentenced him to a diet of worms. He had to just eat worms for the rest of his life. Just kidding. They called him before the Diet of Worms, which is a way of saying he had to go face a church council. And when he went before this church council, they told him that he had to recant what he was saying. Martin Luther answered back to them with these famous words, "Here I stand. I can do no other." Now, why did he say that? Because his conscience was compelling him to stand up for these weak, poor people who were being exploited by this predatory practice of the church. Well, that got Luther exiled. And he literally had to flee for his life. And while Luther was in exile, he began to translate the scripture in the common German language of the people of his day. Now, there's something you take for granted in here this morning. Several things, actually. One of the main things you take for granted is that you have a copy of the scripture in your own language that you can understand and read. You even have modern translations that have taken it out of the ancient, antique vernacular of the King James Version and have placed it into a modern vernacular so that you can even understand it better. There are Greek and Hebrew scholars that are able to freely practice their craft and translate the scriptures. You take all that for granted today. But if you had been living during this time, your only access to the scripture would have been what is known as the Latin Vulgate. And the majority of Europe would not have been able to speak Latin, and so you would have been entirely dependent on the church to tell you what God said. You would have been entirely dependent on your priest or upon your bishop, who would have been an interpreter for you, not that you could read it yourself, but that would show you what you were to believe. And they did not trust you with the scripture. That's something today that we have to thank God for, that He has given us this privilege. And so, one of the battle cries of the Reformation became this, in Latin, sola scriptura. What does sola scriptura mean? It means scripture alone. And we're going to talk a little bit more about what we mean by that term scripture alone. But in fact, there were five different phrases that encapsulated what the Reformation was all about. And I want to give you these phrases in Latin, but also in English. Number one, it was sola scriptura, scripture alone. Autocorrect must have put the E on the end of scripture there, because that's sola scriptura, but scripture alone. Sola fide, faith alone. Sola gratia, grace alone. Solus Christus, Christ alone. And soli Deo, sorry about that, gloria, for the glory of God alone. Now, these are things that we look at and we say, well, of course salvation is by faith. Of course I can never work to merit my salvation, and it's completely by grace and all because of Jesus. We say of course to all these things, but people weren't saying of course to these things in that time. These were things that people, men and women like Martin Luther, had to fight for as they returned to the scripture. And so today I want to focus on that first one, sola. Now we've got scriptura, so we're almost there. Sola scriptura. I'm giving those guys a hard time back here. They're trying to change things on the fly, so I'm just going to pick on them a little bit, but they're working hard. Why don't you give them a hand right now? Because we never notice all the hard work they do until the pastor picks on the words that are on the screen, okay? But they do hard work, and I appreciate it. I'll owe them a dinner after this or something. Why is sola scriptura still so important today? Well, besides taking for granted that we have the Bible in our own language, guess what? There's something else that you take for granted. You take it for granted that if I want to come to you and say that you need to believe such and such about God, what do? You take it for granted that I then have to demonstrate that from the Bible, right? Because if I can't show you from Scripture why you should believe this or that about God, then you shouldn't believe it. And you know that, and you've been conditioned to believe that. And that's something that you assume. But that wasn't assumed back then, that the Bible is the primary way that God speaks to us. It is our primary authority, and it is the one book that we can hold in our hands that instructs us in all things necessary for salvation. Now it's important that you get this key critical point here. I did not say that the Bible contains all knowledge that could ever be discovered in the world. Is that what I said? No. The Bible contains all knowledge necessary for salvation. It contains everything you need to know in order to be saved. And that is a key point. So what did the early church believe about Scripture? I want you to look with me in 2 Timothy chapter 3 as we look at this great principle of the Reformation. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Starting in verse number 14. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that everyone who believes or who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. work. Now there's several key things that I want to bring out of this passage today about Scripture and the life of the church. Number one, we see the clarity of Scripture. The clarity of Scripture. Number two, the sufficiency of Scripture. And number three, Scripture as normative. Or nominative, either one. But we're talking about the clarity of Scripture here this morning, first and foremost. If Paul's words are true, that the Scripture can instruct us for salvation through faith in Jesus, then that means whatever I must believe to be saved must be clear in Scripture. Now, there must be some things that are less clear, but other things that are more clear. Are you getting this here this morning? Whatever is required for you to believe, it must be clear enough for you to believe it from the Scripture. Now, if there is something that is less clear, well, that's the things that Christians find to argue about, right? Christians are going to disagree over the less clear things. We're going to disagree over the things like, for instance, baptism. Some Christians believe that as a sign of the covenant, you should baptize infants. Some Christians believe that it is only believers who should be baptized. These are in-house discussions that we can have, the less clear things. Some Christians believe that the charismatic gifts, you know, things like prophecy and speaking in tongues and words of knowledge and words of wisdom, we taught on these at the beginning of the year. Some Christians believe these continue on and remain vibrant in the life of the church. Other Christians believe that they cease during the time of the apostles. What am I describing to you this morning? I'm describing to you issues in Scripture that may not be as clear, but they're non-essential things. What this passage is telling us, and what Paul said is true, when he tells Timothy that the Scripture or the sacred writings can make you wise or instruct you for salvation, that means that everything you need to know to be saved is clearly in the Bible. You don't need me to come along and interpret it for you. You can get the Word of God. You can read the Word of God for yourself. And you can know what God is asking us to believe in order to be saved. Now, Christian academics call this the perspicuity of Scripture. It's easier for you just to remember the clarity of Scripture. It also means that Scripture is the best interpreter of itself. You guys ever heard that phrase before, that Scripture should interpret Scripture? What does that mean? It means that the more clear passages should be what helps you in interpreting those things that are less clear. And look, there's a lot of things that isn't perfectly clear. But there are truths that you can point to. Let's take one for instance, 1 John chapter 4. It says God is love. Now it can't be any clearer than that as to what God's identity is. So if there are things in the Scripture that make you go, ooh, wow, I'm not understanding God in this way. I'm having a hard time explaining God from what I'm reading, then what you should do is before you get all haywire and before you start worrying about the validity of the Bible, you should go to the things that you know that the Bible says more clearly first and allow it to help you interpret the rest of Scripture. If you're with me, say amen this morning. Amen. We've got a lot of information coming your way, a little more than normal, but I want you to stay with me here. The second thing is the sufficiency of Scripture. Now this goes with the clarity of Scripture, but I want to help you distinguish the two. Not only is the Scripture clear enough to provide for me every necessary understanding for salvation, it is also fully sufficient to equip me for every good work that God calls me to do. That's what Paul said. I'm going to read it one more time when he says that Scripture is inspired by God, verse 16, useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. I'm thankful for the training that I received from other people helping me understand the Scripture, but the best training anyone, pastor or otherwise, can receive is getting the Bible open and getting on their knees in front of the Bible. That's the best training anybody can receive, and it is profitable for that. Verse 17 says, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for 50% of the good works that you need to do. No, the Bible equips you for every good work. That means that the Bible is fully sufficient to help you live the Christian life, preach the gospel, be a disciple of Jesus Christ, disciple others, loving your neighbor as yourself. It provides all the instruction to follow Jesus that you will ever need. And you don't need an infallible interpreter to help you understand that. The scripture is fully sufficient. Now that does not mean that there will not be people, as I said, who will come along in your life and help guide you and help enlighten you to certain truths of scripture. No, nobody gets to go away and say, well, I've got this little set of words over here, and I think I know what they're saying. Now, I've never picked up a Bible in my entire life, okay? And this is the first time I've ever cracked the thing open. And so I'm reading right here where it tells me that there is no God. Did I just read that right? Oh, wait a minute. The fool has said in his heart there is no God. So the thing is, you can dangerously have this rabid individualism where you pick up the Bible and say, I don't need help. And nobody's going to instruct me and help me learn how to read the scripture. And that would be folly as well. That's not what we mean when we say sola scriptura. What we mean when we say sola scriptura is that people will disciple you, people will help you learn, but those same people have to be tested by the word they're trying to help you learn. That means me. I want to help you learn the word, but I want you to test me, and I want you to test what I say by scripture. I don't want to be your infallible interpreter. I want to help you understand God's message for you. Amen? So then if Scripture is clear and Scripture is sufficient, then we must also see Scripture as normative. The third point here. Now this means that Scripture is going to stand in the life of the church as the thing which is the standard against which we judge all beliefs. This is what that council at the Diet of Worms could not stand about Martin Luther. Because he was telling them that he would recant his position. But what did they have to do first? They had to show him from the scripture and reason from scripture why he was wrong. They couldn't stand that. They just wanted him to admit he was wrong. And every time they would bring up something, he had an answer from the scripture for them. And he said, so if you can't show me in the light of God's word where I'm wrong, that's my standard. And so here I stand. I can do no other. Scripture is normative in the life of the church. But here's the interesting thing. This is still relevant today in ways that Martin Luther could never have imagined. Because instead of there being this infallible interpreter in the church who is standing over people saying, you must believe what we say no matter what the clear teachings of Scripture say. What do we have more often today, especially in North America? More often today, we have people who have set themselves up over the Word of God as their own infallible interpreter. Their own Pope, if you will. The one who can speak whatever they want to take out of Scripture. And so, when we talk about sola scriptura, we're not talking about individualism. We're not talking about the fact that you can twist the scripture to say whatever you want and deny its clear truths. You can't just simply say, well, I see that it's pretty clear, but it doesn't feel wrong. How many times have you heard that? Well, God knows my heart. I know what the Word says, but God knows my heart. Yeah, God knows that you have a heart bent on disobeying His word. That's what God knows about your heart. But it feels okay. It doesn't feel like a sin. And so what are people doing? They're setting themselves up as the authority over the Scripture rather than allowing the Scripture to provide the norm for what they believe. So then if Scripture is clear, if it's sufficient, if it's normative, then the question you all might have on your mind is, why would we have articles of religion? Now, all of you have been on Wesleyan.org, and you've studied very carefully the articles of religion on Wesleyan.org, right? Wait a minute, I thought I'd get like 100% yes on that one for some reason. No, you haven't been, but there are such a thing. Where we are articulating doctrine, and we are clarifying certain doctrines of Scripture that we believe. Most of them are in the non-essential category. Most of them are in the secondary category. But then why would we embrace things like the creedal statements of the church, like the Apostles' Creed? Why would we embrace that? It's not Scripture. Why would we embrace things like the Nicene Creed that came from the 4th century? That's not Scripture, but yet we would embrace it, and most Protestants across the world today would affirm it. And literally all Christians pretty much everywhere would even say that yes, the things that they declare are authoritative. They are truth. What is being said in these creeds, while not Scripture, are absolutely the truth based off of Scripture. Why? Why would we say that if the Scripture is clear, if it's sufficient, and if it's normative? Well, it's because of that last point. We believe Scripture is normative. I'll put it to you this way. Try to be as simple as I can. With every new generation of Christianity, there are going to be new questions, there are going to be new challenges to Scripture, there are going to be new challenges to right belief that rear their heads. Right now, we've got all sorts of challenges in the church that are coming up where people are questioning what God's Word said, and we're having to go back and provide statements that say, we affirm this is what the Bible teaches. Every new generation is going to face that. But the key is when you face those things, you don't go, what do you guys think about it? Let's take a poll. Poll vote. Who thinks this is right? Who thinks this is wrong? You know, they didn't do that back in the days of the church councils when Arius, the bishop, came forward and said that, I don't believe that Jesus Christ was truly God the Son. The council didn't sit back and go, well, that's an interesting opinion. So let's all see, you know, maybe how many of the rest of us feel that way. We'll just go with that. If that seems right, we'll just go with it. No, what happened? Well, the very council from which we get the Nicene Creed that we affirm today was taken over by men like Athanasius, who stood up and reasoned from the Scripture. And said, no, it is because of our belief in the Scripture that we must believe that Jesus Christ is God the Son. And so what the creeds did and what the councils did was to go back to Scripture and argue from Scripture as normative. The Scripture was the standard by which doctrine could be more clearly developed and articulated. But make no mistake about it, the truth was always in Scripture. How many of you are aware that nowhere in the Bible is there the word Trinity? Do you know this?
Yes.
Nowhere in Scripture. Nowhere in the Bible is the word triune God. So why do we believe it? And why did those men believe it? Well, it's because from the Scripture we see three very important things. Number one, there is one God. That's pretty clear. Deuteronomy 6:4, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And then we see in Scripture, in the New Testament in particular, that there are three persons who are called God. Explicitly, clearly, called God. And then we see that these three persons exist eternally with one another. And so even though the Scripture never says the word Trinity, using the Scripture as our standard, are you following me? We then realize that we are left with nothing but to believe in the doctrine of the Trinity because of what Scripture does clearly state. So I want to be clear this morning. Standing on sola scriptura does not mean that there are things that we have yet to learn from Scripture. Standing on sola scriptura does not mean that there are theologies to be developed. Standing on sola scriptura says Scripture must stand as the primary and sole authority as we face these new questions in the generations to come. If you're with me, say amen, please.
Amen.
And then lastly today, I just want to say how grateful I am for our own tradition, the Wesleyan tradition, and what we brought to the table when it came to the Protestant Reformation. This is true. John Wesley and Methodism came along over 200 years after the Reformation. But it was Wesley who famously said, "I am a man of one book." Scripture was, without a doubt, his one sole infallible authority. Yet John Wesley brought an angle to this that I'm so thankful for today. Not only did Wesley stand on the authority of Scripture, Wesley stood up, and he stood for a vibrant, daily, lived-out intimacy with the Holy Spirit. It was Wesley's experience in the Holy Spirit that set him apart from most Protestants of his day. It wasn't just a faith that went to the Word and then died there. It was a faith that went to the Word and found the Word to be vital and living and active, and that the Holy Spirit moved through this Word. And so as he and George Whitefield and Francis Asbury and Thomas Coke went all up and down the eastern coast of North America, standing on the Word of God, 200 years after Martin Luther took his stand, and they would preach, we hear of moves of the Holy Spirit that were so powerful that people couldn't stand under the conviction of the Spirit. Their knees literally gave out. We hear of people who would grip the back of the seats and their knuckles would be white as they would shake because the Word was so powerful under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. We read the testimonies of the revivals that took place because a group of men took an idea that was incipient in sola scriptura and said the whole Bible then should be for the whole world, and we want to take it to every single person who will listen. John Wesley brought the angle of revival and the Holy Spirit to the Reformation in ways that he had never been before. But I want you to make no mistake about it. It was absolutely the truth that Martin Luther stood for 500 years ago that brought about what we now know today as these revivals. The road from Wittenberg led to a place called Aldersgate. And Aldersgate was a place where John Wesley, after struggling with his salvation for many years before he ever became the powerful preacher that took North America by storm, before he ever preached to thousands in the fields and thousands under the brush arbors and thousands going into work in the coal mines, before he ever preached in the open air, John Wesley was a man who was struggling to even know if he knew God or not. And the reason I told you that Wittenberg made its way to John Wesley is because one night in 1738, on a cool, clear May evening, John Wesley walked into a meeting with a group of, who would you know it, but Moravians who had a Lutheran German background. And he sits down in that hall that night, and he relates the story like this. In the evening, I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate. You see, you're not alone here this morning if you were dragged to church, okay? I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street where one was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans. About a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation. And an assurance was given me that He had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. You want to know why I'm so thankful for the Reformation this morning? Because the 95 Theses that were nailed to this door made their way in a simple message. And in all the complex things that I've shared with you this morning, it made its way into the simple message of a man's heart that went like this. You are saved by grace through your faith. It is nothing plus Jesus. It is nothing minus Jesus. It is by grace through your faith in Him that you are saved. And that message was taken by the Holy Spirit through the centuries. It was guarded and it was protected, and it found its way into the heart of a man who found himself strangely warmed by it. And friends, hearts have been burning ever since. The revival has sparked at that moment, and it has not died. The greatest revival movement the world had ever seen came out of the Methodist movement. And then out of the Methodist movement came the Pentecostal and the Charismatic movements, which were the most explosive movements in Christianity that the world ever saw. Friends, I'm here to tell you today that the Reformation is still alive and it's on fire in us. I want to focus in closing on our gratefulness to the Father for preserving Scripture for us. Psalm 19, starting in verse number 7. Hear these words of the Lord about His Word. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned, in keeping them there is great reward. Can I just close today by making an appeal to you? You are among the most privileged group of Christians in the history of Christianity. Are you hearing me this morning? You have less constraints on your faith. You have more liberty to practice your faith. You have more liberty and tools and resources available to you to help you study the Bible than any generation since Jesus. And it is a tragedy when God's people don't love God's Word. I talk to pastors all the time, and I don't like to get up here and whine, but there's things that discourage us. And one of the primary things that discourages us is the apathy of God's church towards His Word. When we see week in and week out the sheep coming in to church to engorge themselves on the Word for that day and then live their anemic, starving lives the rest of the week, never cracking open Scripture, never so much as getting their phone out and clicking a button with an app on it to read the Word. One of the things that we know is when people are in the Word and they're loving the Word, they're asking questions about the Word and the Word is being discussed among them. I don't want to be your infallible interpreter that you hear on Sunday mornings telling you what you're supposed to believe. In fact, at the risk of your coming to different conclusions than me, I'd much rather you have reading the Word on your own. And then come to me even challenging. Because if you know me, I love a good discussion. And I love to talk through the Word. And I love to listen to counterpoints to the things that I believe and to offer thoughtful things to the things that you may need to go on and believe. And it will not bother me one iota. And you say, well, no, I'm in it. I'm reading it. I just don't want to bother you with it. Trust me, friends. There's a lot of things you can bother me with. That wouldn't be one of them, okay? That's the one text that I love getting. Is when somebody says, I was reading in Hebrews this morning, and this just was so powerful, and I'm wondering what you thought about this. Friends, if it is any time of day and I've got the moment, I'm going to respond to that. That is a joy in my heart to walk through God's Word with you. And one of the things and the reasons that we know that we're not devouring the Word as a group, as a church enough, is when we know that those kinds of conversations are fewer and farther between. So I want to encourage you. I know you're a church that loves preaching, but I want to encourage us, and this is just a family discussion this morning, I want to encourage us to be a church that loves to devour the Word of God every single day. If you've gotten so hung up because you've tried to get through Genesis and you've tried to go through Exodus so many times and you stumbled and you failed, I want you to stop obsessing with reading it from Genesis to Revelation and just pick up the book and read the book. Let the book feed you. Yes, I believe that you should read it through. I believe you should read it cover to cover. But if that's what gets you stumbled up every time is because you get stuck in a genealogy in Numbers, then get somewhere else in the book and keep going, okay? Because it's God's Word for you.